that we can get oriented from beginning. So the question today why we are gathered is why mucormycosis surge is there right now in this COVID-19 pandemic. This is what we have been seeing for last almost a year now. And there have been a lot of efforts, giving indications why COVID-19 is responsible for this surge of mucormycosis. Though there are a lot of indirect evidences now are available in hand to associate COVID-19 with the mucormycosis. Mucormycosis, we all know, is a disease we know for years and decades, which involves an immunocompromised individual. This is a fungus which invades immunocompromised individuals, particularly the diabetic mellitus, which is the most common immunocompromised condition. Besides this, a lot of other conditions affecting the immunity, like transplantees, organ transplantees, neutropenic patients, other malignant hematological disorders, and other things which can invite the mucormycosis. But why particularly? This has been going on for years. But why this sudden surge in COVID-19 pandemic is important to know and understand? Why this is not moving? Yeah. So, COVID-19, we all know, targets immunity. It has association with immunosuppression due to several reasons. We all know in all COVID-19 patients, it targets the T lymphocytes and results in lymphopenia, which is an important part of our innate immunity system. Reduced CD4 and CD8 counts are seen in more than 80% patients of the COVID-19 affected patients. And this is one of the strong reasons to suppress the immunity of these individuals. This is not the only reason. With COVID-19, especially diabetic patients with added immunosuppression, along with corticosteroid therapy, adding on to the immunosuppression result in this overall infestation of this dreaded fungus mucormycosis. So COVID-19 itself, by means of several ways, leads to reduction in immunity, and lymphopenia is one of them. It leads to inflammatory cytokine surge, particularly interleukin-6, which leads to surge of ferritin. Ferritin is a very, very important, molecule here when we are discussing mucormycosis. Because mucor is the fungus which requires iron to grow. For its survival, it needs a lot of iron. Interleukin-6 surge leads to hyperferritinemia, and which leads to a lot of intracellular accumulation of iron, and that free radical surge leads to iron in the free iron in the serum. There is usually no free iron in our serum, and the mucor, even if it goes in the serum, doesn't survive without iron. With this surge in hyperferritinemia patient, there is huge amount of iron for the mucor to grow, and this is one of the strong reasons. That's why you see a lot of physicians after the cytokine surge getting ferritin levels, and those are the patients which are susceptible to mucor if they are diabetic and if they are taking steroids and other things. So it's a complex interplay of so many things. COVID has known to induce endotheliolitis. Endotheliolitis means direct attack by the viral load on the endothelium cell, leading to raw endothelium, inducing prothrombotic state because of the raw endothelium inviting thrombogenicity, inviting thromboembolic events, and that leads to a lot of de novo cases without even mucormycosis. There are lots of publications showing lots of thromboembolic event leading to morbidities, like Madam Namrata is here. Lot of reports of central retinal artery occlusion because of the COVID-19 thrombogenicity, thromboembolic events. So such events have been published. They do happen because this induces a prothrombotic state. And in the mucor also, mucor has a, angio invasion capacity. It preferentially invades the vessel, and that leads to fibrin plaques, blocks the vessel and the blood supply of that particular area, and leads to necrotic SCRs. So this prothrombotic state is already induced by COVID-19 with further corticosteroid and diabetic results into this mucormycosis infection. And this COVID also, it has an effect on the beta cells of the pancreas, and has recently been reported leading to insulin resistance and inducing a pro-diabetogenic state. A lot of patients not being chronically diabetic, developed diabetes after the COVID-19, added with the corticosteroid therapy, and ultimately developed mucormycosis. So this is something which cannot be ignored. So COVID is indirectly, along with the corticosteroid and the diabetes, mostly in the diabetic patient, is responsible for the this kind of mucormycosis, which we have been knowing and seeing for the last couple of months. Now, how the diabetes affects? Diabetes, we all know, is in itself is a pandemic. It's a global pandemic, and diabetes affects the immunity by several means. The most important, which is relevant to the mucormycosis, is the impaired neutrophilic function. You know, this mucor is ubiquitous in the air. It is a normal commensal in our nose as well, but it doesn't invade the tissues as the immunity is normally good. But when the immune function, and this immunity is served by the neutrophils. Whatever this mucor spores coming to the nose, whatever we inhale, are taken up by the phagocytes, neutrophils, and expelled. When the immunity is at stake, when the neutrophilic function is impaired by means of diabetes, by means of further corticosteroid therapy, by means of COVID-19, the added immunity suppression, this impure neutrophilic function allows this mucor spores to germinate into hyphae, and which are invasive. That's how it invades the nasal tissues first. This nasal and pulmonary, mucormycosis starts with the nose first, because it is due to inhalation of the mucormycosis spores. And that's how the impure neutrophilic activity allows them to germinate into hyphae and invade the tissues. So diabetes is the core thing, and majority, more than 95% of the mucormycosis presently are in diabetic patients because of this sole region. Along with this, diabetes results into certain other regions leading to the mucormycosis. As I mentioned about the iron, ferritin level. In diabetic patients, when there is particularly ketoacidosis, the transferrin, as I mentioned, the iron is nowhere in the serum free. It is bound to the proteins like transferrin, lactoferrin, ferritin. This diabetic ketoacidosis doesn't allow the binding of transferrin to the iron. The free iron is there in the bloodstream, which is important for the survival and growth for the mucor. And that's how it promotes the growth of the mucor, by means of preventing the binding of iron to the transferrin. This is one of the reasons. Another reason why mucor preferentially invades the vessel, that is simply because of the increased glucose regulated protein 78. This is found in the endothelial vessels, and this mucor has a receptor of this protein to invade the endothelium vessel. It enters the elastic lamina of the vessel, induces the fibrin plug, and ultimately blocks the vessel, clogs the vessel, and the further blood supply of that vessel is blocked, resulting into necrotic coagulative necrosis in the necrotic areas, which are required to be removed by the surgical means, because all those necrotic area are loaded with the fungus. There is no penetration of antifungal drug, for which surgery has a main role. That's why we are here, to know the fine nuances of the surgery, to discuss in detail. So there are so many reasons why diabetes is so important and induces this this mucormycosis during this COVID-19 immunosuppression pandemic. And most important, added on to this, like Dr. Srikant Shinde mentioned, the judicious use of steroids. That is the key factor now, number one factor now, inducing mucormycosis. We all know steroid is an important tool in the COVID-19 management to curb the inflammation induced by the cytokine surge due to COVID-19. See, steroid doesn't kill the COVID-19. It curbs the inflammation induced by the COVID-19 related cytokine storm. Now, what is happening everywhere in the country, or maybe everywhere, the moment the patient is diagnosed with the COVID-19, the fear factor is so much. There is no direct drug to combat the COVID-19. And many a time the physician give a cocktail therapy. Cocktail means as an antiviral, there is a broad spectrum antibiotic, there is a steroid, there is an anticoagulant, and number of drugs are listed in the prescription for a disease which has no treatment so far. And what is happening with the broad spectrum antibiotic, antiviral, and particularly steroids, all ultimately attacking on the immunity. And steroids have a huge impact on the function of neutrophil for their chemotaxis, for their migration, for their toxins release, and everything is related to the neutrophils, and everything is suppressed by the steroids. So COVID-19, diabetes and added steroids, this triage of these three is leading to this surge of mucormycosis cases. This is what we have understood so far. So steroid is an important drug, but should be judiciously used. Like Ashish said, to formulate some guideline to some suggestions to the government, steroids should not be given in the early course of COVID-19 disease. Steroid should not be given for the mild cases of, you know, COVID-19. Steroids should be reserved when there is cytokine surge on day 5, day 6, when the viral replication has happened and the cytokines are inducing the inflammation involving the chest. And that time, there are guidelines from the Indian society to give a particular dose of methylprednisolone or dexamethasone every day for 3 to 5 days. But what is happening, by and large, the patients have been advised steroids from day 1 to day 10, day 15 for the fear of, because there is no drug, at least the steroid is working without knowing the future consequences. So steroid should be judiciously used during the COVID-19 course of the treatment. And then post-treatment, that is a very, very important time where the otolaryngologist should pitch in. Rather, I would recommend all cases, particularly diabetic patients, particularly those patients who had cytokine storm, who had huge lung disease, who had undergone ventilation and other major treatments, must be followed periodically to the otolaryngologist to look for any possibility of early mucormycosis developing. That is why we have gathered here. Like Dr. Srikant Shinde already mentioned, the early diagnosis of the disease is the key. Because this disease is known to catch the nose first. The earliest symptom come to the nose. Then, if it is not diagnosed, not treated, it spreads to the maxilla, the surrounding bones, and then to the orbit very quickly. We have seen so many patients coming with a blindness, unilateral, bilateral, simply because of mucormycosis, undiagnosed mucormycosis. Those patients who have been treated for the COVID extensively with the steroids without proper glycemic control, without proper blood sugar control, that is the key to the entire management. And that is how this huge surge of mucormycosis cases we are witnessing. So we need to be very careful during the treatment of the COVID-19 patient and keep an eye particularly on those high-risk situations. Like these are listed high-risk situations. These cases should be kept on under close observation even after the post-treatment. Even after the patients have been free from the COVID-19 treatment, like patients having neutropenia, patients who had earlier high interleukin 6 and ferritin level, who had been treated with a steroid for long, who had undergone this tocilizumab treatment as a tool for cytokine surge, which has not been proven so far. But let me say, no single drug has been known so far to work on COVID-19. In spite of that, so many treatments are going on, and without knowing the fact that that may have some adverse consequences on the patient later on. And that is what we are discussing, the sequelae of COVID-19 here today. And one of them is mucormycosis. So all these level, all these patients are high-risk patients, should be followed post-COVID treatment to the otolaryngologist on a periodical basis. The reason being, these patients, the best treatment for these patients are reserved when they are picked up in the early course in the nasal phase. When the mucor invades the nose is the earliest phase which can be treated easily without needing of too much of treatment, too much of surgical debridement and too much of antifungal treatment. And how you can pick up? You have to make some sort of awareness to these patients. Any diabetic patient, post-COVID particularly, having complaint of excessive dryness in the nose, excessive crusting in the nose, any sort of paresthesia, anesthesia on the nose, on the face and the teeth or surrounding region, anywhere slightest of these symptoms are pointing to the mucor inflammation, mucor infestation. And the otolaryngologist, if it is, he is following with the endoscopy, the earliest sign to pick up the mucor is the excessive crusting in the nose. That should raise the suspicion of the mucor. We should have a low threshold in diagnosing the mucor in such situation on endoscopy. And once you have any slightest suspicion, the next investigation to order is a gadolinium enhanced MRI. That is the need of the time to diagnose this disease earliest in the course. A lot of people having this kind of finding or suspecting the mucormycosis order the CT scan. Believe me, CT scan has big zero role, no role in the diagnosis of mucormycosis at all. The reason why I'm saying is the treatment of mucormycosis involves debridement of the necrotic or devitalized tissue so that you make the situation permeable to the amphotericin or the medical treatment. Because this disease, the mucormycosis, preferentially invades the vessel. It blocks the vessel, blocks the blood supply, and that blood supply going to that particular region, area, the mucosa, bone, nerve, lymphatic tissue, whatever it is, gets necrosed. And a necrosed tissue without having any blood supply is not going to be treated by any amphotericin or anything. Nothing is going to work. So there comes the role of surgery. So before surgery, the workup is so important. The reason being, like Ashish has already mentioned, the goal of surgery, if you see carefully, the goal of surgery is the removal of the devitalized tissue so that you can improve the penetrance of amphotericin to the rest of the area. The second goal of the surgery is whatever involved tissue, whatever maximum you can remove safely. It doesn't mean the radical removal of an enhancing area. And obviously to establish the histopathology. So the goal in the treatment, the first goal and the important goal in the treatment is to ascertain the areas which need to be debrided. And how can you ascertain? One and only means the MRI. Let me tell you, MRI is life-saving to these patients. Because MRI, once you get a gadolinium enhanced MRI, the gadolinium will reach only to those areas where the blood supply is on. Those necrotic areas, which is blocked by the mucor thrombus, those areas are the areas where the gadolinium is not going to reach. So, how can you pick up easily what areas need to be debrided? Get a gadolinium enhanced MRI. Those areas not showing contrast enhancement or showing lack of contrast enhancement are the areas need to be debrided. As simple as that. And if you are able to do that, rest of the areas which are enhancing need not to be unnecessarily debrided. Those areas which are enhancing on gadolinium, where the gadolinium is reaching, that your amphotericin will also reach. Why to unnecessarily debride and give morbidity to the patient? That is the role of MRI, which cannot be served by a CT scan, as MRI gives a lot of soft tissue details, which I am going to share with you where the first case starts. So the goal in the workup is to have a complete idea that what need to be debrided. We are not supposed to unnecessarily debride every enhancing area because the gadolinium is reaching or amphotericin will also reach, and that has an important role in the treatment. Post-surgery, in a full dosage when you give amphotericin, actually this is a medical disease for which the treatment, the gold standard treatment is antifungal, that is amphotericin, the most potent one. Surgery is not the answer to this problem. The role of surgery is just to facilitate medical treatment by means of removing only devitalized area. Like we are dealing with a gangrene. Just simply we are dealing with a gangrene. The drug is not going to reach. That is the source of infection for the propagation of the infection. Because this infection is so dreaded, in no time it reaches eye. It can involve the eye by contiguous involvement. Without contiguous involvement, even it affects the eye, it can lead to blindness by means of fungal emboli and reaching to the central retinal artery. A lot of cases we have seen. We have so many patients admitted with the blindness with no contiguous fungus in the orbit. So, and further from the orbit through the orbital apex and by perineural and perivascular area, it can easily go to the brain. We have patients which has already given, this mucor has already given infarction. So the goal of the entire workup to understand this disease, we have to understand this triad of mucor, this triad of COVID, corticosteroid and diabetes is responsible for this mucormycosis surge. And the goal of treatment, the first role is surgery to remove the devitalized tissue, and that is decided by the MRI. if after surgery or in surgery you are not able to remove the complete devitalized tissue, you are back to square. That load of fungus will remain inside the devitalized tissue and it will keep on propagating the fungal infection further very fast. Like Ashish earlier mentioned, you have to be very, very careful while executing your surgical process so that you completely remove the devitalized tissue and then amphotericin work like some magic. So if you see the literature, the mortality rate of mucor varies from 30% to 80%. And majority of those publications, if you see, they've never ever considered the MRI as a tool to diagnose what area need to be debrided. That's why the high mortality rates have been described. In our hands, in last 1 year, we have dealt with more than 300 cases now with mortality rate less than 1%. Believe me, the single reason behind that is the extensive debridement of the necrotic tissue. We have debrided so extensively that the skull base bones, both maxilla, entire cribriform plate, entire frontal bone, entire cribriform plate, everything, soft tissue hanging, the eyeballs, brain, everything hanging and reconstructed with the soft tissue. But the success was simply due to removal of the all non-enhancing areas according to or guided by the MRI. That is the key to the success of the surgery, to have a good MRI, to get a complete information about what need to be debrided, what need not to